So essential character. Character. Finished. Also include the reference to an article complete or finished, enter it as unassembled to disassembled. So we have another concept. Unassembled or disassembled. All right. I'm bringing in markers. When I clear them through customs, I'm a licensed customs broker. I find out that the cap is missing. Markers are brought in without a cap. They're probably all dry, but anyway, they're at the border without a cap. Do I classify them as markers? Is it a complete marker? Do markers usually come with a cap on? Yeah. Because if I take it off, it will dry. It will become useless. But guess what? Markers come without a cap for a reason. Because they come with this felt tip, which is dry. Because once it is brought into the United States, in the factory, it will be filled up with the ink, and then it will make sense to put a cap on. So not only it comes without a cap, it is not dry. It comes as dry without ink. So the question is, how in the world I classify this product? It's really not a marker. It's not like I can take it and use it right away. There is still some work to be done. So in other words, the marker comes as incomplete product, right? You still have to put ink in. You still have to put a cap on to be able to use it. So what are the rules within the GRI that allow me to classify this as a marker? As a complete or ready to use marker. While I know the marker is not really ready to use, you still have to fill it up with ink, and you still have to seal it with a cap. And in this situation, GRI 2A, General Rule of Interpretation 2A, comes to the rescue. You have unfinished, incomplete marker. No cap, no ink. But if you look at it, it has essentially appearance of the marker. All you need to have done to it is just fill it up and put a cap on top, and it will be ready to go. So from the bird's eye, or I guess from the analytical perspective, it looks like the even though the marker is incomplete, it has a buzzword, essential character of a complete marker. So this word, essential character, is hugely important word. Because essential character, if it has no essential character of the marker, you really cannot classify it. So let me really use the same example. What comes in is not the marker, but the cap. Just the cap. Does the cap have essential character of the marker? No. It can be put on, but we look at it and we just don't, it doesn't feel like a marker to us, right? So notice, there is really no definition for essential character. There is really, it's really hard to pin it down because in every case, it will be different. But if you look at it, it's kind of like a look and feel test. And if it looks like a marker, then you can classify it as a marker. If it's not, then probably it's not. Unassembled to disassembled, same thing. You have a shipment, a marker comes in a shipment of two boxes. In one box there is a marker, in another box you have a plastic top. So it all comes in the same shipment. It is unassembled. Do you classify one as a marker and the other one as a plastic closure? Or you classify them as just a marker, one marker? Well, according to the GRI 2, because the product is unassembled to disassembled, because it is one product, it just comes in different packages for various reasons, whatever reason there may be. But it comes in different, but it comes in the same shipment. Very important, same shipment. Then it is meant to be as one product, and GRI 2A allows us to use only one classification number where we would otherwise use two numbers. Let's have another situation. Let's make it more interesting. A shipment comes in. We have one marker. We have two tops, two caps. They are packaged separately. How do we classify them now? What may, so again, we go to the text, right? Now we have unassembled product, right? Unassembled, disassembled product. But really, we only need one cap, right, to make it assembled. This is extra part. What does it mean? That means that now, because this is extra, this is not a necessary component. This does not, this is goes outside of unassembled to disassembled circle. We really classify this portion, those two things, as one HTSUS, as a marker. And then this, we classify it as a plastic top, plastic cap. Because really, this is just an extra part. It can be a spare part, it can be whatever part, but it really is not a necessary component. So under the GRI 2A provision, really essential character is determined by only those two portions. And if this is extra, it has a separate classification and separate, of course, duty rate. Yeah? So that's GRI 2. In a textbook, I use example of bicycles. So look at the bicycle. So you have a complete bicycle, right? And you have a bicycle without wheels. So how do you classify bicycle without wheels? Do you classify it as like bicycle parts? Or do you classify it as a complete bicycle? Well, to me it looks like this bicycle, all you need to do is just put a couple of wheels on and it's ready to go. To me it looks like this is essentially a complete bicycle. So most likely my first feeling is yes, I would bring it in and assign a number as, even though it's incomplete, it has essential character of finished bicycle. So this looks like more like this than parts. Now picture this. I took the chain off. Will it still be a complete bicycle? Okay, let me take the pedals off. Let me take this front frame off, the fork. Now you start to approach this question mark. At what point it becomes essentially not a complete article, right? But essentially like a spare parts or components. Let's take the brakes off. And by the time I'm left with just this frame, I'm more likely to classify it as really a part of the bicycle rather than the whole thing. So do you see how really you cannot really put the exact definition on? You have to kind of look at the item on case-by-case basis. So the point is, there is no clear boundaries. And this is what makes it difficult for the students. They sit down, they want to look for rules, right? You look for rules so you can answer the question correctly. And here you have this essential character, which is a scary concept. It's all about gray. Oh, very often it's about gray. So here I recommend to turn on your humanity. Just become a human, you know, just stop being a customs broker examinee who just sits and just thinks strictly in terms of GRIs. Just think about human. To the average human being, this essentially looks like a bicycle. And if you can say without winking, with a straight face, you can say, yeah, it looks like essentially a whole bicycle, then essential character allows for classification as a complete bicycle. Any questions? So, of course, judges, as well as customs, they try to capture the concept of essential character. And this is the closest they could come to capturing. They set out the list of factors. And the list of factors which you need to analyze in order to establish the concept of the essential character. And the list of factors boils down to the size, the amount, the weight, the value. It can be small value, such as like a diamond, right? But because of the high cost, it may be that the product is all about the diamond. Purpose in use, how it is being used in the general terms, and marketing, which kind of ties into the use. Because you look at the literature, you look at the aisle, what section of the aisle it is being sold in, and you determine that, for example, you have a chair, you use the chair to sit on, you do not use the chair as a ladder. So you cannot classify the chair, even though you use the chair constantly to climb on it and to do whatever you do using it as a step stool or as a ladder. But if it's a chair, it's marketed as a chair, you classify it as a chair, notwithstanding your use of it as a ladder. Another example. Plastic bottles. So those water bottles, or like a Coca-Cola bottles, they really come in like this. And then they're being heated up, and they're being shaped through the pressure and temperature into the various shapes. Eco-friendly shapes, not so eco-friendly shapes, cool shapes, funny shapes, Mickey Mouse shapes, whatever shapes. But many of them start like this. And so when you bring those preforms, plastic bottle preforms, into the country, how do you classify them? Because to me, right now, they look like some kind of laboratory wear, right? You look like you put some kind of bacteria inside, you screw them on top and you pour them to the lab. Of course, lab wear is classified as other articles of plastics, not articles for convenience of packing your goods. So what do you make a choice? Well, the choice is this. Essentially, the bottle preform is the bottle, except it's in an early stage. So because it has essential character of this, even though it is subject to the manufacturing process, it will take that shape. So essential character of this is really manifested by this product, the end product. So that means you can classify it as, even though it's unfinished, you can classify it as as a finished product, which is which provides for the carboys, bottles, flasks, or similar articles under 3923-3000. So unassembled, disassembled, I already talked about. So you have a bicycle with the parts that are separately. And now we get to the general rule of interpretation B. So GRI 2B.